You're listening to the More Than the Music podcast, episode 34, featuring Hannah Kerr.
Fear is something that I deal with so much in my life as an artist. I mean, I never thought I would be an artist, and so there's a lot of fear that comes with that. What if I fail? What if nobody likes my songs? What if this isn't what I'm supposed to do? And so I Stand Here as my anthem of I'm laying down the fear in me, and I'm claiming the peace that only God can give me. The words are just raise me up on eagle's wings, give my soul your bigger dreams. And that's my story as an artist, as a person, is just that God has given me dreams, but his dreams are bigger. And so he'll take our dreams and make them into something so much bigger and so much greater than we could ever imagine.
You're about to hear how Hannah Kerr is overcoming the fear and doubt of being a new artist, how she manages going to college full-time with a rigorous touring schedule, the embarrassing nickname that we both share, and how Mark Hall of Casting Crowns not only sings on one of the songs on Overflow, but the larger role he's played in Hannah's music. I'm Justin Paul, along with Hannah Kerr, and we're going to talk about a lot more than just the music.
More Than the Music is hosted by Justin Paul, a touring musician turned national radio personality who loves the dramatic, humorous, sometimes tragic, and often inspiring story behind the songs from your favorite artists. You can connect with the show at wayfm.com/Justin. Now here's your host, Justin Paul.
I am so thrilled to be joined by Miss Hannah Kerr today on the More Than the Music podcast. How are you, Hannah?
I'm doing great. Hey, everyone.
Thank you so much for doing this. We're going to talk about the songs on the album Overflow. Plus, we're going to get to know a little bit more about you. You're kind of new to Christian music, I guess, in a sense that we're just kind of hearing about Hannah Kerr. But when did you start doing music?
Yeah, actually, my parents were worship leaders when I was growing up. So I always grew up around worship music and always grew up in the church, which I loved. And so I started leading worship at my church when I was in high school. And that's where I fell in love with leading worship and being a worship leader. And so all this just grew out of leading worship. I never thought I would be an artist. I'm really introverted, honestly, and I'm not shy, but just introverted. And so God really just kind of made this dream happen, and I didn't even know I had this dream, but I'm so grateful. It's so clear that this is what God had been intending for me to do. And so to watch him work it all out and just watch him be so faithful has been awesome.
So with your parents being worship leaders, I'm sure you got pulled up on stage when you were a kid.
I did, yes.
Did you sing like all the little Christmas carols?
Actually, yes. The first song I ever sang, there was a spotlight in the middle of the stage, me, tiny me, in my little dress singing Silent Night for the Christmas show.
But you didn't know at that point that this is what you wanted to do. You thought you were just too shy to be on stage.
Yeah, I never thought. It was just not something that I was ever on my radar, really. Leading worship always was. I always wanted to do that. But as far as, you know, making albums and stuff, that just feels like a God orchestrated thing for sure.
Yeah, and so you grew up in Buffalo, New York, is that right? And now you're
basically Canada.
Yeah? I mean, I grew up in South Georgia. I'm sure those are like polar opposites.
Oh, definitely.
Temperature wise. Yeah. But then you moved to Nashville like right before your freshman year. That had to be a big adjustment.
Yeah, it was definitely a hard season in my life. We lived in Buffalo for my whole life. We had never really moved. We lived around family and friends. And so when we moved to Nashville, it was a culture shock. But also, I was going into high school. So I'm still in my awkward, 13-year-old stage where I don't know who I am. I don't know what I'm doing. And so I had to make friends. And it was really tough. I feel like that was the time of my life when God really shaped me, though. I feel like that's when my character really became who I am today, is just from spending time with God in that time when I didn't have a ton of friends and learning how to dig into what he wanted me to be instead of the dream that I always thought I would be, which was teaching and leading worship. But yeah, I mean, his plan is always so much better than ours. And so now I can see how moving to Nashville has shaped who I am.
Yeah. 20 years old though, man. So like life right now for you is crazy. I mean, you just got off this Casting Crowns tour. How awesome is this?
It's been crazy, insane, awesome. I'm actually in college full time as well.
What?
And so, yeah.
How do you do all this?
I don't know, honestly. I always thought I would go to college, and so I go to Belmont University in Nashville, and so I go to college, and then on the weekends I do shows, and for the fall for the tour I did take off a semester, but I'm going back full-time this semester, and yeah, it's been crazy, but it's cool because I get to be just a normal college student, and then I get to do this awesome thing that God's opened up for me to do, so best of both worlds. I kind of feel like I'm Hannah Montana sometimes.
Well, in Nashville, it's probably not that weird. I'm sure like you're going to college with a bunch of other aspiring singers and songwriters
true.
Too, right?
Yeah. And I'm actually not a music major in school. I thought about, majoring in voice or something, but I really felt drawn to be a religion major just because I really want to work in a church. It's really important to me to be connected to the local church and to be serving and doing ministry, as well as being an artist, and kind of combining those two things together is so important, I think. And so I'm a religion major. I'm a worship leadership focus major or whatever. And so I've been learning Hebrew and
That's awesome.
This crazy stuff, but it's really been great.
I imagine that type of stuff would be awesome to know if you're writing songs, especially if you're able to interpret the Bible in new ways.
Yeah.
I'm sure that leads to cool things that kind of pop in your head as you're writing.
There's so much meaning in the scripture when you have it in its Hebrew form or Greek and you can read it in that way. There's so much meaning. And so it's really enhanced my songwriting and my understanding, and it's been really, really cool to have that understanding now.
I feel like that might be rare for someone who's kind of on a trajectory with music to continue in college. Usually you hear people like, once they find out what they're going to do, they kind of just give up college and start doing that.
I know. But I really do feel like God has allowed me to do both. I can't explain why. It's just He's opened up these doors to do both at the same time, and it's worked out up until this point. And so until it doesn't work out, I'm just going to keep doing both and hopefully graduate. I mean, I would love to graduate, but if not, I mean, if God has something else, if music is the full-time thing you ask me to do, then I am more than happy to do that, because this has been so fun.
I started in radio when I was 16, and like by 18, I was like, I'm just going to do this.
Yeah.
I'm not going. Still to this day, my parents, hey, when are you going to college?
Oh my goodness.
Like, I'm 30 years
old. I'm
30. I'm not going back to college, okay? I'm done.
Yeah.
But you're doing it now
while
you're like,
it's true. I just want to get it over with. I just want to do what I can and then be done eventually.
Yeah. Moving from Buffalo, your dad came to Nashville first. So what was that time like in between when he was in Nashville and you guys were still in Buffalo?
It was definitely hard to have my dad literally commuting 12 hours to Nashville and back.
He drove?
He doesn't fly, so
what?
Yeah, he prefers driving. I know, it sounds crazy, but that's just one of his things. So he would drive 12 hours every 2 weeks to be home. So it was kind of cool, though, because my brother Michael, who now travels with me on the road, kind of stepped up as the father figure whenever my dad wasn't there. And that's really how we became best friends. People always say, there's no way you're really best friends. I'm like, no, when you have a time like that, you grow really close and you rely on each other. And so that's just how our life is now.
Michael's actually here.
He is.
I wasn't necessarily planning on bringing him up. But Michael, come on, grab this mic. Join us for a little bit here. Now, she's saying all good things about you now.
All good things.
But I'm sure as brothers and sisters, you've gotten on each other's nerves before.
I don't think so. We've never fought in our lives. Always.
What's one thing that you know will get on Hannah's nerves the moment you start doing it?
Oh, man. You know, there's a few things, but no.
I see you being gentle right now.
Yeah, I gotta be really careful. Remember, I play guitar, so I need a job.
Oh, you're in the band.
Yeah, he needs to keep his job. I guess I could fire him, Careful what you say, brother.
I know, that's the worst. The one thing that can kind of get under nerves is I have a nickname for Hannah.
A nickname.
Here we go.
Yeah,
here we go.
Sorry, I apologize.
And it comes out, people.
Yeah, the nickname I have for her is Bean.
We don't know.
There's no reason?
No good reason. It just kind of happened out of thin air. And so, you know, we'll be meeting some people and
usually
saying, hey.
Important people.
Right, yeah. Yeah, you know, and it'll be like, hey, this is Bean, Hannah. Weird.
All of his friends, his wife, everybody calls me Bean.
Yep.
And I guess it could be there could be a worse nickname. I do have a few worse ones, but not from him. So that's the worst.
It can't be any worse than the one I got when I was in youth group as a kid. They used to call me Nugget.
Okay, that is literally what my manager calls me.
Seriously?
Hannah Nugget, literally my little Nugget.
We can share in the embarrassment.
Yes, this is the embarrassment we share together, Justin.
So, there's food nicknames going on here.
I mean,
like,
I guess. I love food. It kind of does fit. So.
I always detoured people from calling me Chicken Nugget, and I was like, no, it's Golden.
It's the Golden Nugget. We are the Golden Nugget.
That's right.
That's what it is. Embrace the name.
So nicknames are one thing that gets on your nerves. And what about him? What do you know gets on his nerves?
Oh, yes. Okay, so... In our family, our sport really is music, because we were never really great at sports, but Michael is the most athletic person I think I've ever met. So he got all the athletic genes, and he eats super healthy. And so when he's on the road, he doesn't eat desserts, he doesn't splurge, I'm like, miss food.
Yeah,
like, if there's ice cream, I'm eating it, okay? No, if there's pizza, I'm eating it. Anyway, but he never does. He just gets salads and protein and all this stuff. And so I always make fun of him for his salad that he's a rabbit. And he embraces it now. Yeah, he's true. Like, yeah, I'm a rabbit. It's fine.
Mm-hmm.
He eats what my food eats. So.
That has to be tough. Like on tour, that has to be tough because I've been backstage and I've seen like buckets of Skittles and pizza.
Yeah,
and
yeah, people say like, you know, the freshman 15 in college. Yeah, it's like the tour 30. I'm pretty sure. Seriously.
Yeah. Yeah.
So for me, it's the tour 45, obviously, because, you know, freshman 15, no.
So, like, you're in the band, too, so you're obviously traveling a lot.
Yep.
Do you ever, like, just need a break from the family? Like, you ever go, like, you know what? I'm not going to go out on this run. Like, we've been together all our life. I'm going to take a weekend.
Yeah, you know, it's actually really cool. The reason why I feel like the Lord kind of prepared me to be in the band with Hannah is that I have a unique opportunity to walk alongside her, and she kind of took a chance on me because we've always led worship together. Like she said, our parents are worship leaders, but at the same time, we moved to Nashville and I played acoustic guitar. How many acoustic guitar players are there in this little city? And so she kind of just came up and asked me one day and said, hey, would you ever want to play guitar for me? And I'm, you know, I play in the key of G, the worship leader key, and
me
move
too,
a capo.
Literally.
You know what I mean? Like that.
No,
was...
he was better than that. But it's funny because he was going to play professional baseball, and then I asked him to be in my band, and he said yes to me. So go me.
Awesome, man. Like, were you going to college to be in baseball, and then?
Yeah, it's a crazy story. Belmont was actually my number one school out of high school, and the Lord blessed me with a pretty awesome high school career, and I felt like the Lord called me to a little college in Buffalo called Houghton College. And so I went there for 4 years and kind of said, all right, Lord, you know, I won't do baseball. That's fine. And then he just continued to bless that. And so my senior year, I had a couple teams look in and I visited with a few and was prepared to take that next step and kind of do that. And then I just kind of felt like the Lord called me out of it. And it was the craziest moment because what I thought the Lord was going to do with my life, I had that direct line of, all right, I'm going to play professional baseball.
Yeah.
And then the Lord goes, just kidding, I have something different for you.
And then here I am asking to be my guitar player.
And so then Hannah signs the artist deal and says, hey, do you want to play acoustic and sing? And I was like, I guess, yeah. And so the doors just kind of opened and the rest is kind of history.
It's kind of awesome because it's like a piece of home everywhere we go.
Yeah.
You know, the road is awesome. It's so fun and traveling is great and meeting all the people. But the part that I didn't see is it's hard to be away. You know, we're away a lot. We're only home like 2 days a week, if that. And so to have home traveling with me, that's pretty cool. It's a really nice thing for me because I'm young too. And so I don't have a family of my own yet. And anyway, it's really great.
I had two dreams when I was a kid. The first one was to be a professional baseball player, and the second was to be a professional musician. I did the professional musician for a little bit. The baseball, it's more like just church league softball right now. So.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with that.
But that's, you know, I couldn't hit a 95-mile-an-hour fastball if I wanted to, so I hit a slow one that's tossed to me by an 85-year-old man.
I love it.
And I push buttons and talk for a living. So
I love it.
You never know where the Lord's going to take you.
Yeah, true.
You have a dog, Baxter, too, right?
Yes.
Is it he, she?
He.
I guess it's a he.
Yes.
Does he get to come on the road with you, too?
No. I think maybe if I ever have like my own bus or my own tour, I think I would bring him. But currently, I share a bus with Matt Maher, so I don't know how much Matt Maher would love my dog being on the
bus
with
me. Is the dog cool? Is he tame? Or is he like wild and crazy like my dog and hates everybody?
Here's the thing about my dog. He's actually secretly a person, I'm pretty sure. Like, he acts like a person. I'm not kidding. Until you meet him, people don't believe me, but then they meet him and they're like, he is a person in a dog costume. We can't explain it. It's so weird. Like, he just thinks he's part of the family. And he really is. I mean, honestly, my parents were not dog people, but then we got Baxter, and now they're definitely dog people. Well, my mom is. I don't know about my dad.
Yeah. Working on it.
We have a 15-pound cockapoo, so half cocker spaniel, half poodle. He hates me.
Oh,
he
good.
Loves my wife. He
I
barks at
it.
Everything. He is the loudest, most obnoxious dog in the entire world. We actually this weekend bought him one of those thunder shirts. I don't know if you've seen these.
The calming thunder
shirt.
Thing. Yes.
Night and day, like.
Really?
We put it on him and he just like froze. And I'm like, this is the best the dog has ever acted in 4 years
that
we've had. Thank
you, Thundershirt.
Thank you, Thundershirt. Like, on tour, my dog would just go nuts. He'd bite everybody's head off.
Oh boy.
So moving along into your music, the first song off the album, Warrior, I know is one of your favorites. And you've even heard some response stories, people responding to you after they've heard this song.
Yeah, it's been a real big blessing for me being on the road and singing this song every night. It's the first song I sing every night when I go on stage and the first song on the album. I feel like it's a good starting place for people. If you're in a place where you're staring in the face of fear, that's when you have to decide, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep the hope alive. I'm a warrior. And so a lot of times when I'm signing autographs and stuff, people will come up to me and they'll have a story about warrior. And they'll say, you know, I found out that I had cancer and then I put warrior on my chemo playlist. And that's what I listen to when I get my treatment. And those are the kind of things that just, as an artist, that's all I could ever pray for, is that my songs would impact someone in that way. It would keep, literally keep their hope alive during a time like that. And just story after story of people going through, you know, the darkest time in their life and then finding hope in a song that I've been blessed to sing. It's just a big blessing for me as an artist, but even more so as a Christian, to know that God has been using me like that. It's been really cool.
Yeah, I think that's one thing that in Christian music that is so cool, an opportunity that we have that a lot of other genres don't, is that we really inspire people with our music. Like, there aren't just words, there aren't just cool beats, they aren't just melodies. These are truths that people use to get through difficult times.
Right. And I think, too, other genres of music, it gives them happiness for a moment and they're like, I love that song. But with Christian music, you're giving them hope for a lifetime. Like, you're inspiring them, not just for the 3 minutes that they hear the song, but afterward, the Lord could bring that song to their mind and remind them of a truth that He wants them to know. And so that is why I do Christian music. I would never do anything else. You'll never stop me.
Yeah, what's that like for you when you hear those stories of people responding to your music that way? That's got to be pretty cool, right?
I'm just so grateful. I mean, it brings me back to every time I hear a song on the radio of mine. There's a lot of emotions, but I think the biggest one is just being grateful, because it means that the music that I've made is so much bigger than me. It's awesome with radio, because if I'm hearing it, that means that thousands of other people are hearing it too, people that I may never meet personally, but the fact that God has allowed something that I've gone through to speak to them and that they would be able to hear it, it's just so much bigger than me. And so those stories are just a testament to that faithfulness of God, of allowing things that I've gone through to impact others.
You've listened to WayFM a lot, obviously, since you moved to Nashville.
I am such a fangirl of WayFM.
So you hear your songs on WayFM. It actually gave me a moment of joy the other night when I was backstage at the Very Next Thing tour. You like pointed me out by name, which never happens. Like, people, I introduce myself, hey, I'm Justin Paul, I'm the night guy. Oh yeah, you're the night guy. I don't know if like my face just doesn't match my voice or whatever. Like, other DJs don't have that problem. But me, it's like, oh, okay, I guess that kind of looks like you. But you're like, hey, Justin Paul. And that actually was like, someone knows me.
I mean, I follow you on Twitter and I listen to WayFM.
You did say you're like, you look just like you do on Twitter.
Yeah. Hey. I mean, hey, I am a fan of WayFM. It's true. I feel like I know so much about everyone's lives on WayFM because you guys talk about it. And I know things. Like, I just asked Justin, I was like, how was your vacation in Montana?
I was like, what? How did you know that, you stalker?
I know, right? Watch out for me, guys. Hannah Kerr coming through.
Man, one song that's been all over WayFM lately is the song Radiate. Tell me the story behind this song.
Yeah, Radiate was really fun. It was the last song I wrote for this album. And I actually got to write it with my oldest brother. So Michael tours with me, and then our oldest brother, Joshua, actually writes songs for a living, which is really cool. And we got into a writing room with this other guy who's really cool, and I had this idea for Radiate for a long time. I love the idea that radiate means to emit light from a bigger source. And for us, that light is obviously the Lord. His light overcomes the darkness. And anything that we can provide is just because God has been pouring light into us that we can give to others. And so Radiate is really special to me. It's just kind of a testament of, in the dark, God's light does shine brighter. You're looking for His light when you're in a dark time. So to have a joyful song that really talks about something serious was important to me, because I think that's something a lot of people need to hear nowadays. There's so much darkness in our world. But if we look to God in those times of trouble, He's going to light up the dark, and He's going to make us radiate for His glory. No matter what comes my way, I'll let my life radiate your light now, always. I'll let my lips speak only for your name. In the good, in the bad, in the mistakes, no darkness is going to stand in my way. If my way is your way, then you'll make
it's good stuff. I mean, I love that you're getting to hear like your worship songs on Way FM now and stations across the country, but you love doing worship covers.
Yes,
I've seen this on YouTube a lot. Like, you do a lot of worship covers. Why do you keep doing that? You've got your own songs to sing now, Hannah. You can do your own stuff.
I just think there's so many talented worship leaders, talented writers in Nashville, and I love their songs. I'm such a fan of Christian music. I love worship music. So to cover those songs, I think, is really cool because it helps me, you know, meet their fans and me connect to them and show them who I'm interested in. And it's a cool opportunity that we get to do. We do like candlelight covers.
Yeah.
Where we just kind of sit by candlelight and we just worship. And that's the video that goes on YouTube, which I love. I just think that's a good window into who I am.
Yeah, there's a lot. Like Good Good Father I've seen.
Yeah.
Check it out. Where are you on YouTube?
It's just Hannah Kerr Music and their candlelight covers. I've done Thy Will Be Done by Hillary Scott, Good Good Father, Great Are You Lord by One Sonic Society, and just lots of other songs too.
Hannah is a true music fan, like a true Christian
music
fan.
I mean, it's what I grew up on. Christian music is such a big part of my story. The fact that now I get to be part of other people's stories. Like, I was that little girl in the sign line, so nervous to meet, you know, all these people. Amy Grant. If I ever met Amy Grant, I would probably cry. But the fact that now there's little girls that stand in my sign line and I get to be that artist for them is cooler than I can even say. I mean, I was that little girl. So it's
just, yeah, now other girls and musicians are covering your songs on YouTube, I've seen as
crazy.
I was searching.
The fact that a song that I have written or sung or whatever has touched them enough that they would want to, you know, make their own version of it, that's cooler than words can say.
Man, the next song on the album, Never Leave Your Side. What's the story behind this one?
I wrote that song with Meredith Andrews and Jacob Suter, and Meredith Andrews is one of my favorite artists. So she was one of my dream co-writes. And we got in a room and we just were talking about, Meredith and I both do a lot of girls' conferences. We do a lot of worship leading things. And the stories that those girls have are just deeper and darker and, you know, just deeper than I could have ever imagined. And so when they say, you know, I had this boy who, you know, did this to me or whatever, it just breaks our hearts. And so we were just talking about that. And she asked me, she's like, Hannah, what would you want to say to those girls that tell you those heartbreaking stories? And we both just were talking, and I think that the thing that they need to know is that the Lord can move their soul. A lot of things in this world can move our hearts or our minds or whatever, but God touches our soul, and he promises that he'll never leave us or forsake us. So even if that boy leaves you, or even if, you know, things let you down, God will never let you down, and he will never leave your side.
I will never leave your side or call you to.
Yeah, I love this song. And boyfriend Jason, too, like,
if he leaves me,
sure,
you know, God and
no,
I
we're not
that.
We're not claiming that, but I'm saying, like, big brother, how do you feel about this? A cool guy?
Public service announcement. You know, I'm an older brother, so I have to do my job. No. He's a really nice guy. I think that the biggest thing with anybody that dates Hannah is that, you know, you want somebody that can lead her. And so as an older brother, you want to see somebody that can lead her somewhere and that treats her really well. And I think he's a great dude.
How do you have time for a boyfriend? You're in college and on tour.
I mean, I did meet him at college, so it kind of went with the college thing. But no, he's a songwriter as well, and so he gets that side of my life, and he's supportive. I think if you're going to have a significant other, if you're going to have a boyfriend, they should be encouraging and lift you up. And I mean, he prays for me, prays with me, and he's a great part of my life.
Is he a guitar player?
He is.
He's not going to...
No,
your brother,
I mean,
out of the band,
hey,
is he?
Michael's got the automatic one-up because he's been in my life way longer.
Jason, you don't even have a chance,
sorry,
buddy.
Sorry, Jason, if you're listening.
You're not
going to
be in Hannah Kerr's band.
Maybe someday, I don't know.
Your Love Defends Me, you wrote this one with Matt Maher.
Yes, oh my gosh. Okay, talk about dream co-writes. Meredith Andrews, Matt Maher, dream. So I went to Matt Maher's house, and we sat down in his studio, and he asked me what my favorite verse was, and my favorite verse is Isaiah 12:2, and it talks about how God is our strength and our defense and our salvation and our song. And so those are all things that are important to me as an artist, but as a person, just that God is our defender and he's our strength. And so we wrote the song, Your Love Defends Me, and it was really special because Matt looked at me and he said, Hannah, I think this song is really going to speak to a lot of people. I think this is something that a lot of people need to hear. And I agree. We're going through a time where we may feel defenseless, but God promises that he's our defender. Mm-hmm. And so this song means so much to me, and I hope that it impacts so many people.
And what people may not know is that Matt Maher writes a lot of stuff with a lot of Christian artists.
He is a prolific songwriter. He'll sing songs that he's written, and I'll just look at him, and I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Your grace is enough. Lord, I need
you. That was you?
Christ is risen. Like, just these songs that are incredible, and then I had no idea that he wrote them, but he did. He's awesome.
He's got his hand in a lot of artists' music, which is really cool to see, because you think of Matt Maher, and obviously you think of his songs on the radio,
right.
But then, man, he's just got such a great ability, and I love that you got to work with him, too.
Me, too. I was so excited. I was, like, excited for weeks before then. I was like, okay, here we go.
Surely my God is strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends
me. The song that we first heard from Hannah Kerr was a song, I Stand Here.
Yes.
And I remember it was so cool. I almost think it was a God moment. I'd come out of church and we had just had this sermon on peace.
Mm.
And then I get in my car and I'm listening to YFM and I Stand Here was playing.
Wow.
And it was one of the lines that says claiming peace, talks about claiming peace in your life. And the sermon we had just listened to was like how you're never going to have total peace in your life. Like there's always going to be one area that's probably chaotic.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean you don't have access to peace in the middle of your storm.
Right.
And this song just was kind of a confirmation for that after that church service. So,
what's
the story behind this?
I Stand Here is the first song that I ever released, and I chose to release this song first because fear is something that I deal with so much in my life as an artist. I mean, I never thought I would be an artist, and so there's a lot of fear that comes with that. What if I fail? What if nobody likes my songs? What if this isn't what I'm supposed to do? And so I Stand Here is my anthem of I'm laying down the fear in me, and I'm claiming the peace that only God can give me. And so the words are just raise me up on eagle's wings, give my soul your bigger dreams. And that's my story as an artist, as a person, is just that God has given me dreams, but his dreams are bigger. And so he'll take our dreams and make them into something so much bigger and so much greater than we could ever imagine. And I Stand Here is just my declaration of that.
When you think about that verse, that peace that surpasses all understanding, that only really comes from God, because you can have everything in your life completely chaotic. You can be scared, as you're talking about, but yet there's this undeniable peace surrounding the situation.
Yeah.
That only comes from God. Like, I don't get how people deal with junk in their life without God in their life, you know?
Yeah.
Especially and not be completely wigged out by it.
Yeah. I read this verse in Proverbs last night, and I don't remember exactly what it was, but it said, plan for peace and you will know joy. And I was like, that's such an interesting concept. I plan my life so much. Like, this is what I'm going to do and this is what I want to be. But you'd have to plan for peace, and that's how you know joy. And I think I need to plan for peace way more in my life. My life is crazy and hectic, and I'm always planning things, but God is the only one who can bring us peace.
I stand here at your feet. I'm laying down the fear in me. And as your child, claiming peace. Oh, give this heart your victory.
Are you like a organized planner, like by the book?
Yes.
Kind of person? Like if one thing goes out of place, it kind of
destroys
throws
off my day, man. Throws off my day. I feel like a lot of artists are very like, whatever, just go with the flow. But I'm like, no. No, I think I've gotten better about it, going with the flow and everything, but I definitely need to plan peace more often.
My wife is such a planner. Like, she plans everything to a T, and that's amazing, and I love that about her. But sometimes when one thing goes wrong, it's like, what are we going to do?
Yeah.
And I'm like, honey, calm down. Like,
we can just go with the flow. My boyfriend is totally go with the flow. He's like, whatever. Like, we'll just figure it out. And I'm like, no.
Yes.
Like, we need to do it now.
We have to plan it now.
Oh,
like, she had a plan for her life, and I think I completely screwed that up because it took like 7 years for me to propose and
Yeah. But you went to Montana, so that's great.
That makes up for those 7 years.
True,
that Montana, that 1 week in Montana makes up for it all. The last song on the album is Be Still and Know, and this features Mark Hall, who's really played a crucial role in kind of this whole thing for you recently, yeah. right? Kind of a mentorship that's happened between you and him.
Mark Hall is one of my heroes, and I'm not just saying that because he's mentoring me. Before he ever mentored me, he was my hero. He was the first concert I ever went to, like Casting Crowns. That was my first show. And so the fact that he's come alongside me and he's willing to pour into me and share his wisdom with me is incredible. But the fact that he was willing to sing with me on this song makes it, I mean, I'm not going to say my favorite, but it's definitely up there in my favorites. He brought such a maturity and a wisdom to this song. And I think it's cool because it just says, be still and know. Like, you know, if this is all happening, just be still and know that he is God. And so the fact that, you know, you have me on there saying, be still and know, I actually wrote this song for my friend who was having some like issues with college and financial stuff. So to have that perspective of be still and know if you're in that season, but then to have Mark come in and say, be still and know if you're in this season. And it was right after he had just gone through the whole cancer thing. And so to have both of those perspectives coming together and to have his voice on that song, it's one of those things that you may not ever hear on the radio except for right now. but it's one of those things that I hope people find, and I hope they hear that song, and I hope it brings them peace and comfort just to know that if everything's crazy, God is God and you're not, and that's comforting.
Yeah.
Be still and know you don't have to worry. Be still and know to find you where you are. He is good. His love will never let you go. Trust him. Be still and know.
And how cool is it too, like on the very next Thing tour that you just wrapped up, he gets to introduce you to kick off the night.
It's crazy.
Yeah?
I mean, it's cool because who does that? Like, who would come out
right
before their set and introduce the new artist that people really aren't familiar with? But he does. Every night he walks out there and he says, I'm so excited about this girl. She's a songwriter, a worship leader, one of my favorite people. And he just says that to thousands of people every night. And so it's almost like the tour is cohesive from the beginning to the end. It's all something that works together. And I love that.
There's not a better endorsement, I don't think, in Christian music than Mark Hall.
Seriously, I mean, even coming from me, like, total fangirl, and now we're friends, and he's my mentor, and God just works in incredible ways. I'm still kind of, like, I just look at him sometimes, and I'm like, Mark, you're Mark Hall. Do you know that you're Mark Hall? Like, seriously.
You're the lead singer of Casting Crowns.
He's like, so? He just has no, yeah, he's awesome.
Hannah, I'm so glad you're here. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk about the songs on the album Overflow, and filling us in a little bit about what's going on in your life.
Yeah, thank you all so much for listening to the album. I hope you enjoy it. I hope it blesses you. Thanks for having me in today.
Thanks for listening to the More Than the Music podcast, episode 34, featuring Hannah Kerr. Your feedback on the show is so incredibly valuable and so appreciated. So if you've enjoyed this episode or any others, would you kindly leave a 5-star rating and review inside iTunes? I'd also love to connect with you. You can find out more about the show and even have a chance to win an autographed copy of Hannah Kerr's CD Overflow that was featured in this episode at weyfm.com/Justin.